Is there a particular book that you would love to dictate in the future at some time to sort of bring to your fans who see?
The book that I shall be dictating one day is still in progress, and it begins, "When my first mate died, I left the clan and went to walk the world. One day, I came across the tracks of a giant." It's a darn good film that I've written, and I've got to go out and shake the money tree and get it there. It's about the ancestors of everyone in this room, actually. In the Ice Age, 22,000 years ago, there was probably a mile of ice above us here. Mm-hmm. By 18,000, it's beginning to recede. By 14,000, we have the beginnings of agriculture. By about 12 to 10,000, we have the beginning of city and empire. Climate does change, and changes very rapidly. But those ancestors of ours, we've been around for possibly 200,000 years, Homo sapiens sapiens. We shared the planet with other hominids, Homo habilis, Homo Neanderthal, the hobbits, the Denisovans, and there are almost every month they seem to be finding a cousin of ours that went extinct fairly recently ago. Neanderthals probably disappeared about 35,000 years ago. My giant, obviously, is Neanderthal. And my hero sets out to kill the Neanderthal because the giant symbolizes death. But of course, when it comes to it, and he realizes the vulnerability of the old Neanderthal, he ends up caring for it as it dies. Incidentally, what do we get from Neanderthal? I'll tell you. The Neanderthals used to like to decorate their dead with red ochre, and we don't know why. Is it because they wanted to show that life was there, or to imitate life, the red of life in the dead face? The other thing is, they had this very strange thing that we, Homo sapiens, picked up and copied. When they buried their dead, they would put a large stone at the top of it, which we call the headstone. And we cribbed that from Neanderthal. What was the question? I've forgotten now. Anyway, so the answer is it's about time I did my own thing. I love talking books. They take an awful lot of time. And I am doing, I'm still doing some series. I did a wonderful series for the Canadians about archaeology and demonstrating the veracity of certain aspects of the Bible, for instance. An interesting alliance between Christians in America who are anxious to demonstrate that the Bible is truthful and accurate, and the Israelis, who are really interested in recovering their history and their past. A very interesting marriage, an amazing work being done. But to get back to my beloved story, our ancestors lived at a time where all the other hominids were really under pressure. They survived because the smartest found little marginal areas where they could gain a survival advantage. They lived long enough to have more babies, right? So inadvertently, we selected for intelligence. Everything we hunted was bigger, stronger, faster, swam or flew. The only advantage we had is between our ears. And when you select for intelligence, you select for a bigger brain. And a bigger brain has to have a bigger skull around it. And that bigger skull has to pass through a birth passage. Up until the end of the Stone Age, you'll find male skeletons in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, even their 60s. You almost never find a woman over the age of 30. Up until the end of the Stone Age, the life expectancy of a woman was 21 years. Even in Roman times, it was only on average about 25, though we know of older Roman women, obviously. And the consequences of that are just remarkable. We are the descendants of brave adolescent girls who did whatever it took to make sure that this baby survives. And we are fortunate enough to have had them. But the cost in terms of other things. Have you ever asked yourself why, for instance, men traditionally have given little weight to the intellectual contribution of women? Why, in fact, frequently in our history and in contemporary times, women are not regarded as having anything significant or important to say. In writing this story, I understood why that is. Look, there have been, 40,000 generations of man. We as men go out, we meet each other on a hunting trip. We look at each other, we assess each other. He's young, he's strong, is he dangerous? Could we hunt together? Has he anything to contribute? If my back is turned, is he going to put that rather interesting spearhead, you know, into my back? We've made assessments. We can start to read each other, you know. And even then, con men still take us in completely. We've never learnt to read women. Why? Because it's only in the last 40 generations or so that we've ever met grown women. All our experience has been geared to teenage girls. Now, a 17-year-old teenage girl is wonderful and marvelous, but the difference between a 17-year-old boy and a 35-year-old man is a very considerable one. We never saw that change from girl to woman. Meeting women is a relatively new experience for our species. You know, we never met them. We've never really learnt how to engage with non-teenage girls, and we're only now, as a species, learning that trick. We've only had about 40 generations of doing that. And consequently, the idea that, you know, one should pay too much attention to the bletherings of a teenage girl is ingrained in us. You know, they're wonderful, yes, but, you know, you're not looking for wisdom or philosophy or, you know, a contribution to culture and things like that. And then, of course, once they do mature and have the chance to bloom, then we don't know how to handle that. We cannot read a woman's mind. We've never met the damn. We've not any epigenetic experience to be able to look at them and say, I know what you're thinking. And we always get it wrong. There are two lovely women here. We always get it wrong. Anyway, sorry, that's no answer to your question, but then it was a boring question anyway. Oh, no, did I say that out loud? I beg your pardon.